Thank you. Just to make it clear, of course, I will not be dealing with non-entities like Alan Johnson or John Gray and so on. I mean, read them. If you find anything of any interest in their attacks on me, then you simply shouldn't read. I mean, then you are beyond help. I want to nonetheless seriously answer 2-3 other critical points made. First, a couple of observations about the ongoing political situation in Europe, all the protests exploding. I think that these protests seem to converge in a series of demands which, in their very spontaneity and obviousness, form a kind of, I apologize for this jargon, a kind of epistemological obstacle to the proper confrontation with the ongoing crisis. What people usually demand when they protest is really, what it amounts to, it's a kind of a popularized version of Deleuzean politics. People know what they want, they are able to discover and formulate it, but only through their own continuous engagement and activity. So we are told, active participatory democracy, not just representative democracy with its electoral ritual every 4 years, which just interrupts the voters' passivity. Then we are told we need the self-organization of the multitude, molecular from beneath, not a centralized Leninist party with the leader and so on and so on. It is, I think, this myth of non-representative direct self-organization which is the last trap, the deepest illusion, which is most difficult to renounce. Yes, there are in every revolutionary process ecstatic moments of group solidarity when thousands, hundreds of thousands, together occupy a public space, like on Tahrir Square in Cairo 2 years ago. Yes, there are moments of intense collective participation where local communities debate, decide, when people live in a kind of permanent emergency state, taking things into their own hands with no leader guiding them. But I claim such states don't last. And tiredness, getting tired of it, is not a simple psychological fact. So now comes my first thesis. I will try to be as brutal and provocative as possible. The large majority of people, and I'm not here presenting you the variation of that 99% of the people are idiots, no? I include myself into this large majority. Large majority, I claim, wants to be passive and just rely on an efficient state apparatus. Like, I'm sorry to tell you, but I wouldn't like to live in a state where some kind of permanent participation, engagement is going on and so on and so on. I much prefer to be a passive citizen. There is a machinery of state or whatever, social services, which smoothly does its work, and the less I know about it, all the better. And I don't despise ordinary people for it. Next point. People really know what they want when they are engaged. I claim, no, they don't. Up to a point, I claim, even the majority even don't want to know, really. I claim that we should rehabilitate, of course, not in the old class sense, the term elite. What does a good politician do? A good politician absolutely doesn't follow or learn from the people what they want. No, he tells them what they want. And if he is a really good politician, people have this aha effect. Oh my God, how clear, now I know what I want. And again, I found nothing authoritarian or whatever in this. As to this, molecular self-organizing multitude against hierarchic order and so on. Well, I always start to laugh because when I ask people, especially today, okay, give me an example of this, no? They told me, but you know what's going on in Venezuela? You know, factories being given to workers, they organize themselves in communes and so on and so on. Yes, but if you want a leaderless society, I somehow wouldn't exactly propose Venezuela as a model. You know, you have the big fat guy on the top, which is absolutely inherent to this. It's absolutely naive not to see how, and it's a nice dialectical case, how, of course, sometimes it is happening in Venezuela, a kind of authentic, local, in favelas or elsewhere, self-organization outside the standard multi-party representative mechanisms. But I claim that the leader, which is precisely a kind of a trans-democratic leader, strong, charismatic leader, is strictly correlative to this low-level, elementary self-awakening of the people. They belong together. Is it as if you want real awakening of the people, then you need a charismatic leader on the top. So now, what's my point here? Does this rejection of direct democracy mean a resigned surrender to the hegemonic power structure? Am I simply saying, revolution is good for or direct democracy for a couple of months when things are in turmoil, but then things return back to normal, and so on and so on? No. I think that there is nothing inherently conservative in being tired of the usual leftist demands for permanent mobilization, active participation, and so on. This is the leftist superego logic. The more you participate, the more you are guilty for not participating enough, and so on and so on. The battle, I claim, the true battle of the left has to be won here. By here, I mean in the domain of citizens' passivity. The true measure of change is not those ecstatic moments we are all on Tahrir Square or whatever, but when things return back to normal. Is this normality the same as before? You know, how is your everyday life affected? This is the revolution which is really difficult to make. Let me make along these lines a step further. One of the politico-ideological topics rendered popular by different Deleuzians, Negri, and so on, is the idea that we are witnessing today the shift from traditional hierarchy, a pyramid-like subordination to a master, a shift from this hierarchy to, as they put it, pluralizing rhizomatic networks. Along these lines, political analysts like to point out that the new anti-globalist protests all around Europe and United States, from Occupy Wall Street to Spain, Greece, although Greece is more interesting here, have no central agency. All people, even in my own country, Slovenia, who demonstrate, this is wonderful, there is no central committee, we just meet, we debate, and so on. There are just multiple groups interacting. Again, what I'm tempted to say are two things. First, was it in this room when we had last year a round table where Wendy Brown was here, or in the other room? She made an extremely important point, and since I am nonetheless a moderately polite person, I didn't want to provoke her too much by asking her the obvious question. Namely, you remember when she said how we leftists still behave as if we are fighting a hierarchic central paternal power, while today's capitalism power itself already operates in this, let's call it in fashionable terms, post-Oedipal multitude way, and so on and so on. I mean, the question to ask, I wanted to ask her, but out of politeness I didn't, would have been, is this your family polemics? I mean, because my problem with Judith Butler is that He mostly writes as if the enemy is still some kind of patriarchal identitarian logic. No, as Wendy made it very clear, today's power itself, and this was clear to Deleuze up to a point also, today's power more and more already functions in this non-hierarchic multitude mode, which makes it, and that's the paradox, which makes it no less oppressive. Now, there is a step to be made here, which I'm nonetheless not ready to make it. And I admire my good friend, enemy Alain Badiou, that he made this step, but I'm not ready to follow him here. Namely, there is something nonetheless wrong in what he did. This is my first reply to critics. My first critic is here, my best friend almost, Alain Badiou. In a recent interview, he published a short book together with, and this I will never forgive him, together with Elizabeth Rudinesco, a dialogue where it's quite shocking what they together proposed there. The idea is that since all this Deleuzian horizontal networking and so on is the way, as Badiou likes to put it, today's human animal function, our utilitarian everyday life, the only way to break the spell of bourgeois ideology today is with a new master. That left should reinvent the master. His idea is a very simple one, Badiou's. It's that, you know, Badiou's opposition between animal life, just hedonist individuals, and then subject. Subject as defined by his, her, their fidelity to truth. And Badiou's point is very simple here. What makes an individual, you know, this pleasure-oriented bourgeois individual, a subject is fidelity to a master. It's a total rehabilitation of a master. And I almost admire Badiou here because he goes to the end and claims that there was a deep necessity in so-called cult of personality in communist movement. Lenin, Stalin, Mao. Here is the quote. There are three persons, Rudinesco, Badiou, and then Aeschimann. This is the journalist of Liberation. Now he moved to Nouvel Observateur, who is asking them. Rudinesco, in the last resort, what was lost in psychoanalytic societies is the position of the master to the benefit of the position of small bosses. The journalist, what do you mean by master? Rudinesco, the position of the master allows transference. The psychoanalyst is supposed to know what the analyson will discover. Without this knowledge attributed to the psychoanalyst, the search for the origin of suffering is quasi impossible. The journalist, do we really have to go through the restoration of the master? Badiou, now, quite crazy. The master is the one who helps the individual to become subject. That is to say, if one admits that the subject emerges in the tension between the individual and the universality, then it is obvious that the individual needs a mediation and thereby an authority in order to progress on this path. The crisis of the master is a logical consequence of the crisis of the subject, and psychoanalysis did not escape it. One has to renew the position of the master. It is not true that one can do without it, and especially in the perspective of emancipation. Do you see the nice paradox? Without master, no emancipation. And then Elizabeth Rudinesco does the last kick. Rudinesco, when the master disappears, he is replaced by the boss, by his bosses, authoritarianism, and sooner or later, this always ends in fascism. Unfortunately, history has proven this to us. Now, this is even for me, with my bad taste jokes, a little bit too much. Like, the only defense against fascism is a master. Although, again, one has to admit the obvious element of truth in it, that in today's type of subjectivity. We effectively no longer have a traditional patriarchal master figure. And again, I'm not saying anything extra new here. This was known, for example, already to Horkheimer and Adorno way back in the 1930s, where in their excellent analysis, Horkheimer in Autorität und Familie, Authority and Family, Adorno in his analysis of structure of fascist propaganda, emphasized that the totalitarian leader, Hitler, Stalin, these are not master figures. Nonetheless, my problem is that, I hope we agree here, that of course this post-Oedipal, postmodern subjectivity, infinitely plastic subjectivity, you reconstruct yourself all the time and so on, this one fits perfectly today's relations of domination. That even if you don't have master in this classical sense, oppression can be even worse. This is, I accept this. And furthermore, I think I repeat myself a little bit here that the last time I was here, I already developed this, namely that we have regimes today which we would all have agreed are, in some naive sense, extremely authoritarian, totalitarian, and so on, but they are not the regimes of the patriarchal master. And there was a book written by a guy called, I forgot his Christian name, I'm sorry, it's Myers, M-Y something, called The Cleanest Race. I think, again, that I repeat myself a little bit, but now let's make the point, about today's North Korea. The guy did something pretty interesting. He lived as a journalist in Korea and used the North Korea and used a little bit of freedom that he had to go a little bit, he was allowed to, I don't know how, to countryside. He looked not at the propaganda that North Korea addresses to the West, but at, as it were, propaganda for aborigines, their own people there, and discovered that it's absolutely not, that all this bullshit about Korea being deeply embedded in old Confucian society and so on, no, it's strictly matriarchal. And it's a wonderful, very simple book, but for example, he draws attention to the fact that with all Stalinist retouching and so on, if you look at the official portraits of the leader, the old two ones, now it's different, who knows what will come out of this young guy, Kim Il-sung and Kim Jong-il, the official portraits don't try to obliterate, diminish their tummy, stomach, their stockiness. It's even emphasized. Like, there are some almost embarrassing portraits of Kim Il-sung where you see his stomach and even relatively strong for a man, breasts and so on. So this guy went deeply into it and discovered that the entire state metaphorics, its party and leader are mothers. And he gives some wonderful, maybe you know them, sorry, examples. I don't have now time to quote them all. For example, the most popular North Korean party song is dedicated, of course, to the Communist Party as mother. And it's an absolutely obscene song that we Korean children, people, are like children sucking milk from the big breasts of party, our mother, and we will never abandon your breasts. We need your breasts to survive. And then this guy provides another promise, another wonderful example. He did something ingeniously simple. He looked into the latest edition of the Korean official, like dictionary of Korean language, and looked at the two entries, mother, father. The entry mother is over one page. It goes into mother, all the definitions first, the biological mother of a child, then metaphoric, mother of the family who takes care of all of them, and then, yes, as you expect, in a larger sense, the party is the mother of the people, blah, blah, with all the examples. And then father, one line. The man who helped the mother to become a mother. And then, in a more subtle analysis even, he claims, did you notice how Kim Jong-il, who now died, the middle leader, how he usually had some strange, ordinary winged jacket, and his hair was kind of a, no? That he claims that this is the typical image of a Korean ordinary woman who has these mass-produced plastic jackets and spends hour waiting for food and so on and so on, that it's again a subtle maternal identification. Now, I am definitely not buying here the standard patriarchal bullshit advocated, unfortunately, by some Lacanians like Pierre Legendre in France, according to which, oh, we should return to paternal authority. If you want more power to the women, you get North Korea and so on. No? I'm not saying this. All I'm saying is something much more. Of course, the first thing to note would be here that the obvious thing, you know, which one can learn also from old histories that you know. If you are precisely a woman, beware of societies where you have a mother goddess ruling you, you know. Then actual women are usually even more oppressed than in a standard patriarchal society. So, of course, this mother is a male myth. Of course, at the de facto level, male domination is absolute in North Korea. This guy reports on how even what you get in some communist countries where, as a rule, I remember from my youth and reading books, like, to show how, nonetheless, we take care of women's rights, usually you have three ministries which were, in socialist countries, more or less reserved for women, you know. They are, of course, the soft one where there is not real power. It's education, health, and culture, you know. They can be left to women, but never the serious ministries. So, again, of course, this is a mystified knowledge, but all I'm saying is, nonetheless, this simple fact that, and this is what was nicely formulated already by Horkheimer, that with all the oppressiveness, the traditional paternal authority nonetheless gave you a kind of a support within, for example, Protestant logic to oppose yourself to external authority. You know, like, it's, you know, it's a great, I'm saying this shamelessly, a great civilizatory achievement to have in the ruling ideological ideological structure a space for radical opposition, so that you can say officially, as it were, that it's my right to oppose, society is wrong, and so on. And here, patriarchal authority can, up to a point, play a positive role. But let me now make a step further. I nonetheless think, and Lacan is here much better than Badiou and Rudinesco, that this is an irreversible process. What is going on today is, I think, the final decline of the figure of the master as the symbolic authority and so on and so on. I think they are simply too nostalgic here, Rudinesco and Badiou. No, we cannot return. What happens today with whatever we call it, postmodern capitalism, is that the symbolic authority is fatally wounded, we cannot return to it. So, and I find especially strange from Badiou to advocate this return to the master, because, you know, Badiou likes to emphasize, for example, in his book on the communist hypothesis, that the only politics can be serious politics can be the communist politics. All others are just pragmatic opportunism and so on and so on. Yeah, but I claim that we can only talk seriously about emancipatory politics if the master is not the ultimate horizon of our social life. If we cannot imagine a society which is not held together by a master figure, but in a different way, then we can pack our luggage and just say, okay, let's play pragmatic politics and so on and so on. So again, the challenges are great here. I think that in this debate, Badiou versus postmodern, fluid, plural, multitude figures of authority, I think that both poles are wrong. the structure of a master as well as this polymorphous multitude structure, it doesn't function. There is a challenge here. And there are some hints in Lacan or somewhere that you can have a social link which is not founded on the figure of the master. Next point, now I come more to criticism, would be, where for which I'm often attacked, would be violence. That I am, my God, it's quite funny for me to read about myself, that I'm secretly fascinated by violence, that I'm dreaming about some final explosion where it will be the purifying end of the world, whatever you want. Again, I think that apropos violence, first one should demystify the problem of violence. In what sense? One should reject claims that the 20th century communism used too much excessive murderous violence, and that we should be careful not to fall into this trap again. I mean, of course, in a way, this is true. But I claim that it's not the right way to approach what went wrong with the 20th century communism. Violence is not directly the cause of it. You know, it's not to say, as some naive Marxists do say, and somebody showed to me a book, just the quote, I didn't read it, of course, of Tariq Ali, The Idea of Communism. You know, the book which was published 1 year after the conference on communism, and our book, Ready, which was finished earlier, appeared only a year later. So you can make your own thoughts about it. How is it that a Verso author, the moment he heard about our project, The Idea of Communism, wrote quickly another book with the same title as an answer? Okay, there he says the tragedy of communism was that they forgot about democracy. They didn't, I claim, of course, it was terrifying, recourse to violence. But to resolve the problem, one should precisely not directly say, oh, we should take care of, or we should have taken care of violence, what, prohibit such violence. No, the true problem is what was wrong in the communist project, the way it was formulated in the 20th century, what was wrong in the project as such, so that the only way to survive, he had to take recourse to violence. Violence, as is always the case, was already an answer to a certain deadlock. So as I put it in my book, far from celebrating violence, I think that if we mean what we usually mean by violence, direct physical violence and so on, violence is always, from individual to collective level, a sign of impotence, basically. I mean, this is an old story, you know it. If your father beats you, slaps you, it may hurt you, but it all, as a rule, ruins his authority. The fact that the father slaps you means he was really impotent. He lacked proper authority. And it's the same socially. If you look at all the big explosions of violence, Hitler, Stalin, and so on. For example, what is arguably the greatest violence in Soviet Union? The late 20s, early 30s, the forced collectivization. This violence was one big proof that they were not able to approach properly the problem of peasants, farmers, collectivization, agriculture, and so on and so on. So again, it's stupid to say communists neglected the problem of violence or neglected the importance of democracy. No, this neglect is not simply the last cause. It's a reaction to some deeper failure. Now I will try to answer, I'm sorry for a relatively long quote, one of the critics of myself. It was formulated somewhere, I will even not quote the author because by mistake I dropped that reference. It doesn't really matter. It's a very interesting criticism of me because it is kind of a reaction to my refutal of the first level criticism. The first level criticism is, you know, all this Alan Johnson, John Gray, and Simon Critchley stuff, that I'm fascinated by some violent explosion, blah, blah, blah. I'm really a coward who just dreams of some violence, blah, blah. Okay. Now, when these guys are forced to admit that nonetheless I'm not as crazy as that, then they change the argument and claim that what I am really doing is just putting in provocative terms an extremely common sense obvious point, which is totally acceptable, but just not interesting. For example, when I say the problem with Hitler was that he wasn't violent enough. Okay, at this point you get the heart attack of liberals. No, ah, do you think he should have killed us all, Jews, or what? You know. But then when I add, in the sense in which Gandhi was more violent than Hitler, then they say, oh, it's just that he's making a totally common sense point, that one thing is violence in the normal sense of killing people, another thing is social change. And why do I have to put it in this confusing, provocative way, using the same word violence and both levels? Why don't I just say we have violence as killing people, torturing, which is unacceptable, and we have a radical social change, which is not inherently linked to violence. So that I'm just trying to make a scandalous effect, you know. But really what I'm saying is something even totally acceptable for a liberal. So if you will not say that I'm dreaming the argument, please allow me 2 minutes, a long quote. Zizek is here using language in a way that is designed to be provocative and to confuse people. He doesn't actually mean that Gandhi was more violent than Hitler. What he means to do instead is to alter the typical understanding of the word violence, so that Gandhi's non-violent means of protest against the British will be considered more violent than Hitler's incredibly violent attempts at world domination and genocide. Violence for Zizek in this particular instance actually means that which causes massive social upheaval. In that way, he considers Gandhi to be more violent than Hitler. But this, like so much of what Zizek writes, is actually nothing new or interesting or surprising. And that's why he writes it in the provocative, confusing and bizarre manner that he chooses instead of a straightforward manner. If he would have written that Gandhi accomplished more through non-violence that aimed at systemic change than Hitler accomplished through violent means, we would all agree. But we would also know that there is nothing profound in such a statement. Instead, Zizek attempts to shock us, and in doing so, he covers up the completely humdrum conclusion about Gandhi and Hitler that everyone already believed to be true before they read Zizek. The same is true of Zizek's controversial point about Jews and anti-Semites. There is nothing remarkable about the argument that in the mind of every Nazi who hates Jews, there must also be a fictional Jew for that Nazi to hate. And thus any attempt to rid Nazis of the Jews within themselves, as Zizek tells us Hitler once said, would result in the destruction of the Nazis themselves, since the anti-Semites in themselves require the continued existence of the Jews within themselves. In other words, Zizek is once again simply making a muddled word salad in an attempt to dress up commonplaces as profundity. Gandhi's method for changing things worked because he went after the system itself. The anti-Semite can never kill the object of his hatred because his worldview necessitates the fictional Jew. End of quote. Admit it, you were convinced, no? Okay. In both cases, so you got it, the reproach is the same. I try to sell the common thesis that Gandhi aimed at changing the system, not destroying people, but since this is a commonplace and want to be provocatively popular, I formulate it more provocatively, weirdly expanding the meaning of the word violence to include institutional changes. The same goes for my statement about the Jew is in the anti-Semite, but the anti-Semite is also in the Jew. It's just a garbled way to deliver the commonplace that, in the mind of every Nazi who hates Jews, there must also be a fictional Jew for that Nazi to hate. Like, you know, that the Nazis don't really hate actual Jews, but what they hate, what they construct as the object of their hatred is their own fantasy. But is this the case? What if, I claim, the key point gets lost in this translation of my, as the kind writer wrote, muddled word salad into common sense? In the second case, it's wonderful how he missed my point. My point is not just the effectively obvious claim that the Jew to whom the Nazi refers in his ideological, that this Jew is his ideological fiction. I know this is a commonplace, but I'm saying something else. What I'm saying is that his own ideological identity of the Nazi is simultaneously grounded in this fiction, not simply depending on it. The Nazi is, in his self-perception, a figure in his own dream about the Jews. And this, I think, you see my point. It's not only that the Jew is in me, my fantasy, it's that I am in the Jew, in the sense that I am part of my own ideological dream. It's a slightly more complex point. So back to, now to Gandhi. So why call Gandhi's attempts to undermine the British state in India more violent than Hitler's mass killings? Well, to draw attention to the fundamental violence that sustains a normal functioning of the state. Benjamin called it mythic violence. And the no less fundamental violence that sustains every attempt to undermine the functioning of the state, Benjamin's divine violence. This is why the reaction of the state power to those who endanger it through peaceful demonstrations and so on is so brutal, and why, in its very brutality, this reaction is reactive in Nietzsche's sense, protective. So far from eccentricity, the extension of the notion of violence, so that for me, nonetheless, Hitler was violent, but Gandhi also, is based on a key theoretical insight. And it is the limitation of violence to its directly visible physical aspect, which, far from being neutral common sense, relies on ideological distortion. This is also why the reproach that I'm fascinated by some ultra-radical violence, with comparison to which Hitler and Khmer Rouge didn't go far enough, misses the point, which is not to go further in this type of violence. Like, it's not, oh, why did Khmer Rouge kill only one quarter of Cambodians? They should have killed more, one half or whatever. It's that one should change the entire terrain. It's difficult to be really violent. And the same holds for violence which has any effect on the system. For example, I'm unfortunately old enough, it was possible when I was very young to see them on screen, you know, during Chinese Cultural Revolution, all those thousands of young people trying to get rid of tradition, smashing with even sometimes their hands, old monuments and so on and so on. Already at that point, this did struck me as sign, precisely this physical violence did struck me as, again, a sign of some fundamental impotence. I am tempted to paraphrase here, again, the old Brecht. What is the robbing of a bank compared to the founding of a new bank? What are the violent and destructive outbursts of Red Guardists caught in a cultural revolution compared to the true cultural revolution, which is the permanent dissolution of all life forms which capitalist reproduction dictates? I mean, we have to use the same, you see my point, the same, of course, violence, which I praise, socially the violence of social transformation. Of course, and hopefully it's so, Of course, it's not necessarily brutal physical violence, but the precise point I'm trying to make is that brutal physical violence is an act of cowardice. It's always a reactive violence, an admission of impotence. You explode in brutal destruction when you can't do the, let's call it naively, real social change. Or, as it's a commonplace of leftist critique of Hitler, he had to kill millions not to change things, but precisely to prevent the real change to occur. In this sense, again, to see things in this continuum of violence, how the true violence is precisely radical social change, and it has nothing to do with physical violence. But again, if we simply say, no, but this is social transformation, why use the term violence? We lose this point, which is for me absolutely crucial, of seeing how all those big violent agents, Hitler, even Stalin, and so on, are really modest reactive guys, reactive in the sense of that their violence was an admission of impotence, and so on and so on. So much about this. Now, let's go further. Problem, you will have to pardon me another quote, long. Santiago Zabala, the friend of Gianni Vattimo, recently wrote an essay on me, positively oriented essay for Al Jazeera debate. And then this essay provoked from some multicultural, post-colonial, blah, blah, anti-Eurocentric guys a pretty violent response, predictably accusing me of Eurocentrism and so on. Now, this is an interesting debate, up to a point. Why? Here is the quote again. It's a guy called, he teaches, I think, at Duke. Yeah, do you know him? Is he as stupid as he in real life as he sounds? Okay, here is the quote. I will be fair and again, read you a long passage. As a non-European thinker, my senses reacted to the first sentence of Zizek's article. He is referring to my article on in defense of leftist defense, a plea for leftist Eurocentrism, something like that. Here is what I say. When one says Eurocentrism, every self-respecting postmodern leftist intellectual has as violent a reaction as Joseph Goebbels had to culture. To reach for a gun, hurling accusation of proto-fascist Eurocentrist cultural imperialism. However, is it possible to imagine a leftist appropriation of the European political legacy? That's where he quotes me. And then he, Mignolo, goes on. My response to that paragraph is the following. When one says Eurocentrism, every self-respecting decolonial, this is probably his neologism to be more respectful than post-colonial, no? This is the good term. Decolonial intellectual has not as violent a reaction as Joseph Goebbels had to culture, to reach for a gun, hurling accusations of proto-fascist, Eurocentric cultural imperialism. A self-respecting decolonial intellectual, well, will reach instead to Franz Fanon. And then there is a quote from Fanon here. Now, comrades, now is the time to decide to change sides. We must shake off the great mantle of night which has enveloped us and reach for the light. The new day, which is dawning, must find us determined, enlightened, and resolute. So, my brothers, how could we fail to understand that we have better things to do than follow that Europe's footstep? End of quote from Mignolo, and then Mignolo goes on. We, decolonial intellectuals, if not philosophers, have better things to do, as Fanon would say, than being engaged with issues debated by European philosophers. It's interesting that, but this is just my sarcastic remark then, then of course I asked myself, okay, fuck you, who are these bloody much more interesting intellectuals, no? I was not overly impressed, no? Like, one of them was otherwise my good friend, Van Kui, how do you pronounce it? Van Kui. Well, yeah, you know, the Chinese leftist. Yeah, but I wouldn't exactly quote him as a model of non-European authentic tradition, because I'm on very good terms with him. He sent me recently a text on China and modernization, where he does an operation which I find deeply problematic. He tries to be, I'm not kidding, what I would have called, who was the bad guy who did market economy? Milton Friedman. Like, left Friedman. What he tries to do is to oppose real, just market exchange and its capitalist distortion through monopoly and so on and so on. So there is a true, honest market exchange, and he explicitly, positively quotes Friedman, and then there are distortions which he, in a typical non-Marxist way, he sees the causes of these distortions not in economic relations themselves, but in social pathology. Like he says, when power structure and other social pathologies distort the market, then we get market monopolies and so on. Sorry, I'm, as you probably know, far from being a dogmatic Marxist. But nonetheless, I think that there is something in the demonstration of Marx, how the development from this idealized, simple, just market exchange to exploitation, monopoly, and so on, it's an immanent one. That you cannot just put the blame on social distortion and then let's restore. Okay. Now let's go back to Mignolo. So what Mignolo proposes is thus a version of Baudrillard's battle cry, Oubliez Foucault, forget Foucault, you know, a short book by Baudrillard. Mignolo's proposal is forget Europe. We have better things to do than to deal with European philosophy, even better things than endlessly deconstructing. Mignolo explicitly includes also deconstruction in it. Like, this is still endless narcissistic self-probing. We should simply step out. But, the irony here is that this battle cry obviously did not hold for Fanon himself, who dealt intensively and was proud of it. And like the first obscenity seems to me, how dare he to quote Fanon? Fanon is my hero. That's why I defend him against soft guys like Homi Bhabha, who wrote long text trying to neutralize, normalize Fanon. Like, no, he really didn't mean it with killing and violence. He meant some sublime gesture where there is no blood and nobody is really hurt and so on. So let's face it, Fanon dealt extensively and intensively with Hegel, psychoanalysis, Sartre, even Lacan. So when my third reaction, now paraphrase, would have been, when I read lines like Mignolo's, I reach not for the gun, but for Fanon, for this Fanon. I'm sorry, a long quote, I quote it already in one of my books, but I love it. This is Fanon, this is true post-colonialism. Fanon says, I am a man, and what I have to recapture is the whole past of the world. I am not responsible only for the slave revolt in Santo Domingo. Every time a man has contributed to the victory of the dignity of the spirit, every time a man has said no to an attempt to subjugate his fellows, I have felt solidarity with his act. In no way does my basic vocation has to be drawn from the past of peoples of color. In no way do I have to dedicate myself to reviving some black civilization unjustly ignored. I will not make myself the man of any past. My black skin is not a repository for specific values. Haven't I got better things to do on this earth than avenge the blacks of the 17th century? I, as a man of color, do not have the right to hope that in the white man there will be a crystallization of guilt towards the past of my race. I, as a man of color, do not have the right to seek ways of stamping down the pride of my former master. I have neither the right nor the duty to demand reparations for my subjugated ancestors. There is no black mission. There is no white burden. I do not want to be victim of the ruse of a black world. Am I going to ask these white men to answer for the slave traders of the 17th century? Am I going to try by every means available to cause guilt to burden in their souls? I am not a slave to slavery that dehumanized my ancestors. It would be of enormous interest to discover a black literature or architecture from the 3rd century before Christ. We would be overjoyed to learn of the existence of a correspondence between some black philosopher and Plato. But we can absolutely not see how this fact would change the lives of 8-year-old kids working in the cane fields of Martinique or Guadeloupe. I find myself in the world and I recognize that I have one right alone, that of demanding human behavior from the other, and so on, and so on. Sorry, but that's my position. And he was not a soft guy. He knew what is violent revolution, and so on, and so on. So, again, I found very weird Mignolo to focus on Fanon. What Fanon, end of quote, of course, clearly saw is that today's global world is capitalist and as such cannot be effectively problematized from the standpoint of pre-capitalist local culture. This is why I think Mignolo's view of the anti-capitalist struggle is deeply flawed. Here is, sorry, another quote, which really condenses all that I'm opposed to. Mignolo, again. As we know from history, the identification of the problem doesn't mean that there is only one solution, or better yet, we can coincide in the perspective of harmony as a desirable global future, but communism is only one way to move towards it. There cannot be only one solution simply because there are many ways of being, which means of thinking and doing. Communism is an option, not an abstract universal. In the non-European world, communism is part of the problem rather than the solution, which doesn't mean that if you are not communist in the non-European world, you are capitalist. So the fact that Zizek and other European intellectuals are seriously rethinking communism means that they are engaging in one option, the reorientation of the left, among many, today marching towards the prospect of harmony, overcoming the necessity of war, overcoming success and competition, which engender corruption and selfishness, and promoting the plenitude of life over development and death. End of quote. I claim that, first, Mignolo relies here on a totally naive, for me unacceptable, distinction between problems and solutions. Like, we can all identify the problem, today's global capitalism, but different cultures have different solutions. If there is a thing we really know from history, is that while it's true, the identification of a problem doesn't mean that there is only one solution, there also is not only a single identification of the problem. When we encounter a problem, like a global economic crisis, we get a multitude of formulations in what this problem resides, which are its causes. Like, everybody more or less agrees, we, at least in the developed West, are in some kind of a crisis. But what you will get from different positions is not only different solutions, but simply different identifications, definitions of what the problem is. For example, a radical neoliberal will say It's not too much state regulation, it's on the opposite, that we didn't push enough for state-free liberal society and so on and so on. A Catholic would have said, a Catholic capitalist ecologist as a representative of the Pope said, and there is maybe God punished Pope, because did you see what happened? The moment, a couple of minutes after Pope renounced resignation, it strike on, no? So maybe there is God, but you never know, no? Sorry, so what I want to say is that these different identifications of the problem form a dialectical unity with proposed solutions. I think the first thing to reproach, again to Mignolo, is this absolutely naive opposition of we all see what's the problem, we have different solutions. No, all definitions of the problem are always already formulated from the perspective of a possible solution. Like I was just mentioned the church, one apologist said it's crucial to see that today's crisis is not about capitalism, but it's a crisis of morality. I mean, this definition obviously of crisis is not neutral. Which is why, again, communism, I'm almost tempted to precisely say the opposite of Mignolo and to claim that, yes, while I definitely agree that we should not impose on all parts of the world the same path towards how to get rid of whatever today's deadlocks of global capitalism, but communism for me, at least today, is not solution. Fuck it, who knows how will it look and so on. It's precisely a specific definition, determination of the problem. The idea is that our problems are grounded in the antagonisms of capitalist self-reproduction and so on and so on. On the contrary, Mignolo's identification of the problem, I think, is worth reading carefully. You remember, I will read it again. Here is how he defines our common goal. Allegedly, we all share this opinion. Marching towards the prospect of harmony, promoting the plenitude of life. Well, certainly not my goal, you know. That's what he thinks is a formulation of what we all share. The problem, what is for him the problem? I quote again, the necessity of war, success and competition which engender corruption and selfishness, development and death. So his goal, harmony, plenitude of life, I think it's total empty nonsense. It's an empty signifier which can mean many incompatible things, precisely depending on how we understand plenitude and life of harmony. For example, I can well imagine a fascist saying, Jews and Marxists introduce this harmony, so, life of plenitude and harmony, absolutely, and so on. The fast equation of development at death, as well as abstract rejection of war, corruption, and selfishness, are no less meaningless abstractions. So again, you see the problem that Mignolo encounters the moment he says we share the same goal. And then he proposes his definition of the goal that absolutely I don't share. And I think that would be, but I don't have time to develop it now, not to, that's right. Yeah, no, it's, I'm, don't worry, I'm already almost half into it, so not worry. What I'm saying is that, I don't mean to misunderstand me here, I'm much more politically correct in serious sense of anti-wrong Eurocentrism that I may appear. My critic of Mignolo is not that he neglects Europe, but in his primitive anti-Eurocentrism, he is way too Eurocentric. In a naive sense that what he defines as this broader perspective doesn't work. So what Mignolo offers are not alternate modernities, but I'm tempted to say alternate postmodernities, like we know what's the problem, capitalist modernity, but each of our culture has its own way to step out and so on and so on. Against such an approach, we should totally defend European universalist legacy. How? Haha, now comes the problem, the most probably problematic part. I will take an example of the point that I'm trying to make. What does it mean, the ambiguity of colonization and European universalism, by reporting to you on an incident that happened to me, not even incident, in India when I was there. In a debate, an Indian cultural theorist complained that against me that I am in a privileged situation there, because he claimed it's easy for me to speak English, but am I aware of what an a priori formal oppression or language colonization is? The very fact that for them to debate with me, they have to use the very language of colonization, English, to formulate their very program of decolonization. Okay, so the idea was that the English language means that already formally in their very fight against colonization, they are colonized. I exploded, as you can imagine. First, I made an obvious remark, which was very well received, of typical big nation racism. Fuck him, my language is not English, you know. Like, since I come from small city Slovene nation, it's okay for me to speak English, no? But they, big nation, they have the dignity of whatever. But my serious answer was much more problematic for them. I claim that what this guy didn't see is how, and be very careful here, this is the Hegelian point. This imposition of English, a foreign language, created the very X which is oppressed by it. Because what is oppressed, what they feel, Indian emancipatory fighters, as being oppressed, is not the actual pre-colonial India, but the authentic dream of a new universalist democratic India. So you see my point. I totally agreed with them that they experience English language as imposed, that the fact of being compelled to speak, to debate in English, means that they are deprived of something. But my point was here a much more vicious one. It was that what they feel deprived of emerged only through this loss itself, by them being forced to speak English. It's not the actual pre-modern India, which was just a kind of a oppressive, plural, inconsistent society, and so on and so on. You see the nice paradox that, which is why, incidentally, this is how I explain of how the great intention of British colonizers there was not we must civilize Indians, we must impose of them our values. No, from the beginning they were not so stupid, but in an evil sense they were not stupid, the British. They knew very well that to control Indians they must keep them apart. They precisely want them to stick to their own original culture. If there was no original culture, they even created it. My friends in India gave me, I quote it in, I think, in Living in the End Times, the first chapter. You know, the Book of Manu, it's the great classical text, the Bible of Indian traditional Hindu social thought. It justifies castes, describes in detail the duties, rules, and so on. Nice, but you know what's the paradox? This book didn't exist before 18th century. There were just different fragments here, there. It was put together by British colonizers to have a kind of a unique ideological body to apply it to Indians. So again, what I'm claiming here is that. And you know who knew this? There is another guy who is a tough guy, but he is my hero. Malcolm X. That's what his X means, Malcolm X. It's not simply we blacks were deprived of our original roots, we just have an X. For him, I read him, I'm not bluffing, not totally. X was precisely X of an opening, creative opening. His idea was not just we blacks are oppressed, but precisely because we are, were torn from our original constellation, whatever, and precisely because we are more without roots than the whites, we have a unique chance of becoming more universal emancipated than the whites. Which is why, it may be problematic, choice, but I admit it, which is why, as you all know, at the end, Malcolm X's solution was not some stupid black roots, but Islam. Precisely, in his view, Islam is a radically universal religion. And or to put it in yet another way, more refined, even psychologically. You know, I developed this in my big fat Hegel book. You know, this Lacan's idea that not only language is the house of being, not only we dwell in language, but that language is at the same time a torture house. That we are never at home in language. That's the basic lesson of psychoanalysis called symbolic castration, whatever the bullshit, that there is a fundamental gap imbalance between being human and language. There is always goes something goes wrong. The problem with this Indian vision is that by locating this imbalance into colonial language, you obfuscate the fact that, like, okay, you are tortured by English language, but where is the torturing done to you by your own local previous language? In other words, the most oppressive thing that could have happened to Indians is some kind of false liberation when someone would have told him, okay, let's get rid of English, let's return to your primordial, whatever this was, culture. You know what, how would this liberation look? Warning to those who are sensitive, now comes a really dirty story. A joke about Jesus Christ, which was told to me, I love them, by a Palestinian Christian in Ramallah when I was there. The joke is this one, it's vulgar. Not even good joke, but I like the logic. The last evening before crucifixion, you know, Christ was there praying in the tent and so on, and of course he was God, and they all knew this is his last day in peace, no? So the apostles are worried, you know, like, oh my God, our Lord did such great things, and he didn't have any fun in his life, no? So let's organize some fun of him. So they called Mary Magdalene, no? And says, would you go in and seduce? So that at least the last night he will have some fun, you know? Okay, being who she is, no, she said, oh, gladly, no? And went in after 5 minutes, in a totally horrified cry, she ran out. And they asked her, no, don't worry, Christ is a good guy. He didn't rape her or what, much worse. He asked her, what went wrong? And she said, first, everything was okay. I danced a little bit before our Lord, then I pulled out my skirt, I spread widely my legs, and he looked interesting, and then Christ looked closely at my vagina, and he said, oh, what a terrible wound, and put a hand on it and closed it totally, you know. Like, something like that would have been, I think, return to pre-colonial origins, you know. The whole point is that, how should I put it, to admit the wound, to fully identify with it. Like, for me, again, the true victory over colonialism is not let's return to some primitive local culture, but it's to what is already happening. This is why I have nothing against English language. Intelligent American conservatives already knew it. Okay, English language is winning today. But if you look at it closely, it's no longer American or British English. It's English whose model speakers are probably some kind of a half illiterate in English literature, Singapore merchants or whatever. Or Greeks who will ruin all us, Europe, with their laziness. But that's another story. Sorry. No, but What has all, now I will conclude quickly, but what has all to do with Hegel? I'm so sorry, I don't have time to do it because, you know, I'm getting tired of politics. It may surprise you. I am now in the middle, even already finishing, a big new book on Hegel, which will not be as long as the other one. It will have just 600-700 pages. I'm there now. And I focus precisely on this, how the Hegelian dialectical process is not this type of, from some immediate unity, you have split, and then magically synthesis again. No, at the beginning is the fall for Hegel. The good example would be this Indian example. You have a pre-colonial situation. We shouldn't demonize it. Maybe it was worse, maybe it was better. The problem is just that it was something, as it were, totally different. And also we should not forget there was nothing immediate, substantial about it. It had its own... And the problem is then something new happens, like British colonization, and something is lost. But what is lost is not what was actually lost. What is lost is retroactively created through this very loss. And if you think I'm dreaming here, that's the whole point, for example, of Hegel, of his in his reading of Christianity. He says it openly, that paradise is simply stupid animal kingdom, that loss, fall comes first. Fall itself creates what it is the fall from, that dimension. So again, for Hegel, overcoming the fall does not mean you somehow squeeze back to purity. It means that you fully immerse yourself into the fall and, as it were, you see the liberating potential of the fall itself. Which is why, again, you should be very cautious about this logic of, you know, Hegel, beginning, then things go wrong, then magically they come together. First thing, don't go wrong. They are wrong from the very beginning, as it were. And again, at the end, you don't get any synthesis or whatsoever. And now, if you allow me, nonetheless, 5 minutes to quickly conclude. Why is this important? Because of our present historical moment. I think that what we should get rid of, if we want seriously to maintain a radical emancipatory political perspective, is what I ironically am tempted to call the Hölderlin paradigm. Hölderlin, you know, the German poet, minor one, Kleist was better, but that's another one. You know his famous line quoted endlessly by Heidegger and others, wo das Gefahr ist, wächst das Rettende auf. Where there is danger, the redeeming or solving solution arises also. This reading that today we are approaching some zero point of extreme danger alienation, but this danger at the same time renders possible the solution. You know, like we have this in Marx clearly, capitalism as the utter alienation, but at the same time opening up the possibility of collective reappropriation of the alienated substance. Heidegger, forgetting of being, but care, the reversal, emerging it. Even Derrida, I would have said, is in this very strangely. He always emphasized that we are living in the final moment of the metaphysical closure. That, you know, like metaphysical closure is coming to its end, exhausting its possibility, and so on and so on. I think that what we should learn from Hegel is precisely that this entire paradigm is to be dropped. That what Hegel calls reconciliation is not some magic solution, but it's precisely to this reconciliation with the evil, the fall itself, to see how what appears as evil is at the same time the very recourse of our salvation, like what Malcolm X saw. Yes, X, we were terribly, brutally deprived, but this deprivation, depriving us, white slaveholders, of our black roots, gives us a unique possibility of being universal subjects of emancipation, and as it were, beating the whites at their own terrain. But this solution is not a cynical one. Namely, a cynical one in the sense of, yeah, okay, we need fall to redeem ourselves, so we should manipulate or whatever. With this, I will conclude. I think rather that if there is a lesson, progressive one, from the ongoing crisis, it's that cynicism doesn't work. I was still surprised how even a guy from whom I would have expected more, my good friend Fred Jameson, again recently repeated that old stupidity that we live in cynical times where ruling ideology no longer takes itself seriously, so we don't even need today critique of ideology, we no longer need that delicate Hegelian conceptual analysis of discerning the inconsistencies, the voids of argumentation. Those in power are brutal, they admit everything more or less openly. We live in post-ideological cynical times. You will never surprise those in power by demonstrating to them that they are lying, that they are inconsistent, and so on. I think this is maybe the most dangerous illusion that there is. If there is something to be learned from Freud, it is that precisely this type of perverse, cynical openness is at the same time the greatest illusion. You are really in illusion in social, material social life. Not when you are telling some dreaming stories about divine intervention, but precisely when you adopt this cynical attitude, you know, like, fuck it, what ideals? Let's be frank, it's all about money, power, pleasures, whatever. Precisely this type of cynical realism doesn't work. It's the most, you are most blinded. Why? What you don't see is precisely illusions which still regulate your life precisely when you think you are directly, brutally realist. Let's not forget, for example, the crisis of 2008. It was not caused by some crazy welfare state idealists. It was caused precisely by, you know, that Michael Douglas bullshit, that greed is good, cynical realists. Precisely those who think we have no illusions, that's the brutality of life, they are most. This is the big lesson of Hegel. This does not mean life is just a muddle, we can't do anything, but now I'm really, you see, like, just concluding. I think that what's great in Hegel is that he is a post-eschatological thinker. His problem is not things are bad, but we are there, just push it a little bit and everything will turn around and so on and so on. The greatness of Hegel is that he is a post-apocalyptic thinker in the sense of we tried it, okay, I don't agree with Hegel here, but his idea is French Revolution. They tried to realize freedom, it went terribly wrong for Hegel, I'm not so sure, like French Revolutionary Terror. And then his point is precisely to demonstrate how this doesn't mean we were wrong. We should accept the lesson of what for Hegel is the fiasco of French Revolution is simply the openness of history. It's not predetermined, it went wrong, it just means Hegel does compel us to accept a certain basic alienation of social life. But it doesn't, not in the Marxist sense that, oh, irreducibly we are enslaved to some alienated substance, fate, capital, whatever, to rule us. No, I think Hegel would have loved the paradox of today, which is the more we are aware of how capitalism relies on our own fictions, on virtual reality and so on, so we are well aware there is no capital in itself mystique. We are playing with our fictions and so on. Precisely when we know fully that there is no substantial metaphysical capital with a capital C, that is just we are fighting with our fictions, the less we are able to dominate it. So there is no big other, But this doesn't mean it's just me. It means that the situation becomes much more non-transparent and so on and so on. So again, I think that the lesson of Hegel, now I'm very short, I will develop more, this is my book, is that the struggle for freedom should go on, but we should just learn to accept its dangers. There is no ontological guarantee. It's a risky struggle. There is no guarantee how it will end. We cannot ever step on our shoulder and control the effects of what we do. So again, I think that that's, again, this is what we need today. Because again, the thing to avoid today is precisely, I think, this type of cheap cynicism and some kind of globalized pessimism and so on and so on. No, we have to learn to act without ontological guarantee. I had many more things to say, but because of the Greek terror, I stop now. Thank you very much.